Keeping up with our motto, let learning be a joy and teaching a pleasure, here we are with a remote teaching and learning process to bridge the gap. Happy learning, students.
Welcome, students of Thakur Vidya Mandir High School and Junior College. Students, I am with the last part of your chapter 10th, magnetic field due to the electric current. In this last part, we are going to deal with the topic such as magnetic field produced by a current in a circular arc of a wire, followed by an axial magnetic field produced by a current in a circular loop. We'll be talking about the magnetic lines for a current loop by using the right hand thumb rule. We would be dealing about the Ampere's law. What does the Ampere's law tells us? Further, we'll move that how the Amperean loop is applied on a long straight current carrying wire. The last topic for the part 3 would be magnetic field of a solenoid and a toroid, where first part would be showing you the solenoid, whereas the second part, that is a solenoid turned, would be showing you the formation of a toroid. So let us begin with the part 3 of your last topic, that is magnetic fields due to the electric current. The first topic of your part 3 is magnetic field in an arc of a wire. The figure here shows you the formation of an arc, which is given by a small length L, indicating of a small particle, that is dl, whereas the magnetic moment is given along with a small vector sign, that is db. Formation of the angle is given by theta, and radius is the small r denoted for the length of the arc. Let us consider a straight parallel wire and obtain the magnetic field at a point produced by a current in a circular arc of a wire. The circular arc, which is seen in the figure AB, subtends an angle theta at the center O of the circle, where arc is a part and r is a radius. Therefore, by using the Biot-Savart's law equation, the magnetic field produced at the A could be written as small dB is equal to mu naught multiplied by I multiplied by dl divided by 4 pi r square. This is the direction of the each of the dB is into the plane of the paper. So when I sum it up, the total field at zero is given by capital B, which is nothing but the integral of dB, which is in turn written as mu naught I multiplied by theta multiplied by a value which is called as 4 pi multiplied by r. Therefore, the angle theta is in radians. So this tells us the magnetic field felt in the arc of the wire. The second part of your part 3 is axial magnetic field in a circular loop. Let us consider the diagram which is mentioned out here. This diagram is showing you the magnetic field on the axis of a circular current loop with a radius r. The magnetic induction is denoted by dB, which is perpendicular at a point P, and this is given by a distance which is showing you the slant height indicated by r. Let us assume that the current is steady. Therefore, a circular loop of the wire carrying current I, the loop itself is in the xy plane with its origin O. Therefore, we need to calculate the magnetic field at a point on the z axis. At a particular distance small r from the element dl on the loop, we can use the Biot-Savart's law, and with this we obtain out the formula, that is the magnitude of the magnetic field dB. dB could be written as mu naught divided by 4 pi multiplied by I multiplied by dI multiplied by r, which is in turn the ratio divided by r cube, where dl is in the xy plane while the vector r is in the yz plane. Hence, students, we could say that dl into r is nothing but the product of dlr, and the small magnetic induction could be written as dB is equal to mu naught divided by 4 pi multiplied by I multiplied by d, which is in the ratio of your r square plus z square. Therefore, the net contribution along the z axis is obtained by integrating the dB, which is dB cos theta over the entire loop. This gives us the magnitude of the field due to a current I in the loop of a radius capital R on a point at capital P on the z axis of the loop. Let us now move on to the next topic for your last part, that is the magnetic lines for a current loop. Students, you could see the two diagrams out here. The first diagram indicating the magnetic field lines for a current loop, whereas the second diagram indicates the right hand thumb rule, which is going to show you exactly how the current is acting on a circular loop. Let us begin on with the explanation of this. The first part, that we know that the magnetic field at a point P on the axis is given by the formula, that is BZ is equal to mu naught multiplied by R square divided by 2 multiplied by z square plus r square, which is in the raised to 3 by 2. Therefore, the field of the center of the loop is obtained as B0 is equal to mu naught I divided by 2r. Thus, the magnetic lines from a circular loop are depicted in the figure 10.20. The direction of the field is as per the right hand thumb rule, which is indicated in the figure 10.21. Let me explain you how does the right hand rule works on this magnetic lines for a current loop. Curl the palm of your right hand along the circular wire with the fingers in the direction of the current. The stretched right hand thumb then gives the direction of the magnetic field, and the upper part of the loop is regarded as the north pole and the lower part of the loop is regarded as the south pole of the magnet. Thus, the circular loop carrying a current in a magnetic dipole shows you the different behaviors as I have explained you here. Students, let us understand what you mean by the Ampere's law. We know that if a distribution of the charges is given, one can obtain the electric field by using the inverse square law. If the distribution of the charges is planar or spherical or cylindrical, then it is obtained with the help of a law which is called as Gauss law. Again, if the distribution of the currents have same symmetry, then we can use the Ampere's law to find out the magnetic field with fair ease. Let me explain you what you understand by the Ampere's law. The Ampere's law is given by the formula phi B multiplied by ds, which is turn, could be written as mu multiplied by I. The current I on the right hand side is the net current encircled by the Amperean loop, and an Amperean loop is drawn to encircle 3 of the 4 current wires and not the 4th one, as the current goes perpendicular to the plane of the paper, which you could see in the diagram towards your left hand side. B is the plane of the paper even if its direction is unknown. Integration is the over product of the length dl of the Amperean loop and the component of the magnetic field B cos theta. Therefore, for the distribution of the current I1 and I2 are coming out of the paper, and I3 on the other hand is going into the plane of the paper. Therefore, the phi B cos theta dl could be represented by a formula where mu is multiplied by I1 plus I2 minus of I3, and the current I4 is not within the Amperean loop. The current I4 is shown to be out of the loop. As the integration is over a full loop, the contribution of the I4 to B could be cancelled out. This explains the Ampere's law, which is felt out in an Amperean loop. Students, let us understand what you mean by the Ampere's law. We know that if a distribution of the charges is given, one can obtain the electric field by using the inverse square law. If the distribution of the charges is planar or spherical or cylindrical, then it is obtained with the help of a law which is called as Gauss law. Again, if the distribution of the currents have same symmetry, then we can use the Ampere's law to find out the magnetic field with fair ease. Let me explain you what you understand by the Ampere's law. The Ampere's law is given by the formula phi B multiplied by ds, which is turn, could be written as mu multiplied by I. The current I on the right hand side is the net current encircled by the Amperean loop, and an Amperean loop is drawn to encircle three of the four current wires and not the fourth one, as the current goes perpendicular to the plane of the paper, which you could see in the diagram towards your left hand side. B is the plane of the paper even if its direction is unknown. Integration is the overproduct of the length dl of the Amperean loop and the component of the magnetic field B cos theta. Therefore, for the distribution of the current, I1 and I2 are coming out of the paper, and I3 on the other hand is going into the plane of the paper. Therefore, the phi B cos theta dl could be represented by a formula where mu is multiplied by I1 plus I2 minus of I3, and the current I4 is not within the Amperean loop. The current I4 is shown to be out of the loop. As the integration is over a full loop, the contribution of the I4 to B could be cancelled out. This explains the Ampere's law, which is felt out in an Amperean loop. Now we go to the topic, which is long straight current carrying wire. This is in agreement with the Ampere's law. The magnetic field B of an infinitely long wire is proportional to the current I, but inversely proportional to the distance from the wire, as seen earlier. We have studied that the Gauss law in electrostatics as well as in magnetism is being used up. In case of a long wire, the magnetic field for the given distribution of the currents can be easily calculated. It will then become unnecessary to solve the integrals which appear in the Biot-Savart's law. We know that the Biot-Savart's law plays a very important role in magnetostatics, that the Coulomb's law plays in electrostatics. On the other hand, I could say that the parallel lines where the Gauss law is used is actually electrostatic in nature. The last topic for today's part 3, which is indicating the magnetic field of a solenoid and a toroid. Let us move on to the first part of the solenoid. We have learned about the solenoid in standard 11 qualitatively. Consider a long, closely wound helical coil of a conducting wire. We assume that the diameter of the coil is much smaller than its length. This figure is indicating a schematic diagram of a cross section of a current-carrying solenoid. The density of the magnetic field lines along the axis of the solenoid and at a certain distance are away from the wire is uniform in nature. For a real solenoid of the finite length, the magnetic field is uniform and it has a good strength at the center and is comparatively weak at the outside of the coil. These lines are widely spaced outside the solenoid and hence the magnetic field is weak there. Thus, we could say that the magnetic field of a solenoid could be very easily or clearly understood with the strength at the center and comparatively weak towards the outer side. Within the solenoid, there is one more part which tells us about an ideal solenoid, which is showing you the Ampere's law applied to it. This diagram is showing you two different parts, one which is showing you the dotted part and one which is showing you the cross towards the bottom. Therefore, I could say that the Ampere's law applied to a part of the long solenoid shows that the dots are the current coming out of the plane of the paper and the crosses show that the current is going into the plane of the paper, both in the coil of the square cross section of the wire. In the equation below, the current I is the net current encircled by the loop, where I could say that the BL is given by 0 plus 0 plus 0, which is equal to mu naught I. The other three values are 0. Therefore, we could say that the second and the fourth integrals are 0 because B and DL are perpendicular to each other. And if the number of the turns is n per unit length of the solenoid, the current flowing through the wire is 1. And the net current which is coming out of the plane of the paper is indicated by I is equal to NLI, Although the above results for the capital B is obtained for an ideal solenoid, it is also valid for a realistic solenoid, particularly when applied to the points in the middle of it, but certainly not to the point near the ends. Thus, I conclude by saying that a solenoid can be designed for a specific value of capital B by the choice of small I and n. Let me explain you what you understand by toroid. Toroid is the one which is showing you the figure with a circular loop, which is called as an Amperian loop, which you could see inside are the lighter circles within the radius of this loop and a darker circle towards the outside of the loop. A toroid is nothing but actually a solenoid of the finite length bent in a hollow circular tube-like structure, similar to a pressurized rubber tube inside the tire of a vehicle. This is an example which you could see from any wheel of your vehicle. The magnetic field lines are concentric circles in the toroid, and the direction of the field is dictated by the direction of the current capital I in the coil around the toroid. Again, by the Ampere's law, students, I could write that phi B multiplied by dl is equal to mu multiplied by I, where capital I is a net current encircled by the loop. Therefore, capital B is equal to mu naught I multiplied by n, which is in turn divided by 2 pi r. Thus, unlike the solenoid, magnetic field is not constant over the cross section of the toroid. With this, students, we complete on all the topics of your part 3 of the magnetic field lines due to the electric current. Students, now we move on to your assignment questions. Please go through the link which is mentioned out here. We move on with the first question. Derive the magnetic field in a circular arc of a loop. Second, derive the actual magnetic field in a circular loop. State the Ampere's law, very important from the board point of view. It carries important marks. Question 4, derive magnetic field of a solenoid and a toroid with the help of a neat labeled diagram. Try to understand the topics thoroughly by making the notes with the help of neat labeled diagrams and try to put it down in a systematic manner. Thank you, students.